you have to tell me. I can't fix it unless I know the secret.
I don't know what I did. I don't know. It's your machine, not mine.
Is this thing supposed to be smoldering? I hope you can't fix it.
Computer.
In the early days of computer technology, we heard all kinds of predictions about how computers would profoundly change our lives. It all seemed so futuristic back then. Today, it's reality. For young people, computers are downright fun. But for those educating our children, computer technology presents the biggest challenge since new math. And already, teachers are assessing the promises and pitfalls of computer education.
Hello there, I'm Doug Richards. Computers in the classroom. They're not in every classroom, not yet. Still, the fact is, educators are recognizing the computer as their greatest helper since the chalkboard. And the technology and concepts are still very new to educators. They marvel in its potential, but they're a little leery too, leery of its lack of humanity, mostly. We know a lot about the computer, but there's a lot we don't know too. And those who are teaching our children are scrambling to learn what they can about this newest, most revolutionary education tool. Computers are no longer unwieldy monsters taking up entire buildings, no longer reliant on cumbersome binary codes and tape storage. Computers can now sit on a desk like a typewriter. Theorists like Donna Ide of the University of Nebraska Medical Center point to four revolutions in our educational history. The first was writing, then movable print. The third, arguably, television. The fourth?
And now we come with the microcomputer chip. And it has all the aspects of the previous revolutions in it. We do not need to store information in our own heads. We have a tremendous capacity to store information in alternate forms in a computer chip.
Now, you don't yet see computers in every classroom. The obvious reason.
As far as disadvantages with the computer, number one is expense. Druid Hill is a very special situation because we have a computer lab that has 18 microcomputers, and you're not going to find that in very many schools.
Carla Norlinger is a mathematics teacher at Druid Hill Elementary School in Omaha. Druid Hill is a so-called magnet school, a school with particularly attractive features designed to bring races and classes together for more sophisticated public education. One of Druid Hill's brightest attractions is the computer. Norlinger's math students use these desktop computers to help solve equations, to store information, and to become acquainted with computer technology itself.
First of all, they take a test, and the computer tests them until it picks up a weakness. When this software program, which is in the computer, picks up the weakness, then the child is assigned to a lesson. Each child is working individually at the level that they need to be working at, which is not an easy thing for a classroom teacher to do. The nice thing about this program is that if a child comes into this room and they are competent in addition, subtraction, they don't have to do those units. Let's get them doing fractions and decimals. The instruction which occurs with the computer and the child is on a very personal level in that they're both in tune to each other. The child is very in tune to the computer, and the computer is keeping track of everything that the child's doing. I don't want people to think, though, that the teacher should be eliminated, because there are times when that communication process has a kink, and that's when the teacher needs to come in.
But there lies another challenge, teaching teachers.
If you're a classroom teacher and your youngsters are going to be using computer-assisted instruction, you're going to have to acquire some information about computers, or you're going to be out of step with the fourth grader you're trying to teach.
Most teachers at this time are not being exposed to microcomputers and programming as a requirement in their degree if they're going to be a teacher.
Still, for those who know how to teach with them, who teach at schools that can afford them, computers can be immensely useful. In math, that's obvious. Carl Clark is an art teacher at Valley View Elementary in Omaha. He also teaches students to use the computer.
This is a pioneer approach in terms of what we're trying to do with it as it relates to art. I see it as being the other end of the pendulum. On one end, we have a completely artistic use that doesn't even worry about the keyboard. I know very little about the computer in terms of what it will do on the keyboard. I'm not worried about that. That doesn't threaten me at all. I do know how to touch the keyboard enough that it'll get the commands up so I can do what I want to do. On the other end are the people in the math programs and the science programs, etc., that use the keyboard exclusively. What I see is a beautiful marriage between the two. I see it as a way of introducing them to a new world that they're going to be living with every day. The one thing that we have trouble with as adults is that we don't understand all of these things that are happening. We talk to the kids, and the kids are so far ahead of us, they already know all this information anyway. They're out there doing it, and they're playing their games, and they're rewriting their games, and they're redoing it, and they're wanting to know how to put visual graphics with their programs. They know how to do a lot of this stuff on computers. They simply want to complement what they're doing with the keyboard and putting in some visual information. This allows them to explore what they can do with that aspect of it.
And the exploration is just beginning. Used to be electronics companies like, say, Atari, offered us only fun-filled blips on television screens, computer games. Now advertising would have us believe that if we buy computers that can just play games, we aren't getting our money's worth. In reality, computer buyers often don't know what to think.
One of the major obstacles we have in our stores when somebody comes in and wants to know what the best personal computer is, it's kind of a catch-22 for us, because if we don't know what they want to do with it, we don't know the best possible computer for them. At the same time, from their standpoint, if they don't know what they can do, how can they possibly know what they can do with it?
But once you figure out what you can do with your home computer, the possibilities are vast, and they're increasing.
Whether this has to do with your budget, whether it has to do with your grocery bill, or compiling your records and organizing things for income tax time. Other ways have to do with use of a computer to organize your own physical environment. One example there is to use a computer to turn on and turn off the heat and the lights in an energy-efficient fashion.
Computers are undeniably part of our home and business future. How large a part they'll play and how soon they'll play it will depend a lot on how children learn to use them now in the classroom. Sure, computers are marvelous, useful machines that help us reason and store information better. But many of us, children especially, know best their fun side.
I'm terrible at it. I never said I was pro.
The use of computers by artists and musicians is ever increasing. Electronic rock music, which gained popularity in the mid-70s with groups like Yes and Emerson, Lake and Palmer, is now used by groups that enhance it through computerization. Fresh Air of Omaha is one such group. Chip Davis explains.
We actually use two different types of computers with our show production. One computer basically runs all of the slide elements, which are the visuals on the screens behind here. And the other computer runs basically all of the lighting and special effects. And those would include things like the fog that appears on the stage, the strobes in the stage, and then, of course, all of the overhead lighting. Well, we used to use about 13 people to operate the show, and now essentially we use about 11. So we can do it without two people, but that really is not a true gauge. In order to do the amount of things that the computers are doing, we probably would need maybe 15 people instead of 11. So it, aside from doing a lot of jobs for a lot of other people, it really has made the accuracy of the show very tight. I would say probably about, 70%, I'm just guessing, is run by the computers. There still is a whole lot of manual override in the show that has to be done, and of course all the sound mixing and all the playing, all those elements are all live.
This interest in computers on the part of rock musicians could help nudge some rock fans into becoming interested in them.
Kids seem to really take off on the computers, and I think the major reason is their lack of fear or prejudice, you know, as far as the computer technology itself is concerned. And I think a lot of people are afraid or somewhat intimidated by computers.
Parents are afraid that their youngsters are involved in something that's foreign to them. Parents feel that separation as the youngsters are very casual with technology. Anyone that's watched a youngster in with a video game these days realize how they're irreverent about the computer. An adult still approaches a computer with a certain amount of awe and reverence. Kids, technology's been a part of their existence.
As one gets further in age or further along in the generations, eventually one reaches a group of people for whom the computer is almost an alien intelligence.
Although the computer's place in society seems assured, they still scare some folks, and not just those who don't know how to use them. The same theorists who welcome them into our homes, businesses, and schools also have some reservations about how much our society should absorb them. They're already in our classrooms. Generally, students find them about as friendly as machines can get. They don't scold students for wrong answers. But that aloofness also worries some.
Adults are worried that the humanness of education will be lost. They're worried about the evil purposes that a computer could be used for, because a computer can think without morals, can think without values and without ethics, and when you treat knowledge in a neutral way, there is potential for computers to begin running us instead of us running the computers.
Our relatively short experience with computers has yet to confirm many of these fears. But the worry that computers might somehow replace the humanness teachers provide is still there.
People are worried that youngsters will begin to think like a computer instead of thinking like a human being. And that's the real fear. Computers do not have intuition and insight. They do not have the aha, eureka, I discovered it type of capacity in them. And that is a uniquely human capacity.
Computer use is also disrupting long-held beliefs teachers have had about the learning process.
We all have basically different learning styles. Some of us choose to learn primarily through our visual modality. Others choose to learn through our auditory modality. And what we do is most of us have the skills to compensate for whatever our particular weakness is.
This mainstreaming of education is seen as both a blessing and an eroder of cultural differences.
We do know that with computer technology, that this can begin to close that gap that does exist between, say, the upper class or the upper middle class and the lower classes in our society. One of the drawbacks with that is right now, the computer programmer is still basically your Anglo-American, and he or she is going to have the propensities to program that particular computer to meet their learning style. Well, if that continues as it has, then we will still perpetuate the learning, the academic discrepancy that currently exists.
While narrowing cultural differences, computers in the house and classroom can widen the generation gap.
To what extent computers will become an integral part of our own lives, and to what extent a computer would be an important part of your life, will depend upon your own generation, your age, your place in society, and the problems that you have to contend with.
The mere entertainment value of computers can be harmful. Children are obviously fascinated by video games. Adults can become fascinated by their home computers, and that can cause family problems.
There is a certain seductive fascination to dealing with a machine that does exactly what you tell it to do, and a certain fascination with dealing with something which seems to be directly out of the science fiction age. Now, the advantage to that, of course, is that as a computer is a tool, it can be used to solve problems. The disadvantage to that occurs when the individual substitutes that intense relationship with the computer for other relationships with other human beings that are required for a decent and well-rounded life.
Well, these are some of the potential pitfalls. Perhaps folks heard similar concerns years ago following the advent of the television, the automobile, the printing press, the abacus. And none of those milestone inventions tore our society apart. When man's technology races into an uncertain future, sometimes it takes a while for our wisdom to catch up. The uncertainty many people seem to feel about computers coming into our personal lives is probably quite natural, like fear of the unknown. But in its unfeeling, practical, logical, efficient way, the computer appears to be winning its battle with our fear. Many who wanted to use electronic calculators in classrooms when such devices were large and cost hundreds of dollars, also remember the teachers who forbade students from using them on math problems. Cheating, they said. Today, calculators are cheap and they abound in the classrooms of our young people. Computers today are more rare than calculators, and they aren't exactly cheap, but the price has sure come down over the years. It stands to reason that someday computers, too, will abound in our classrooms. And as far as we know, few teachers have accused a computer-using student of cheating.
Schools have no option but to continue to emphasize computer literacy. The public school system is the only system that I can see which will be able to guarantee equal access to technological information for all youngsters, regardless of income level, and to place values, as they've always done, on the emerging electronic literacy. So the public schools have no option but to take account of this revolution and to understand it, and maybe perhaps to lead the revolution.
With battle lines drawn by academicians, with preteens and adolescents as foot soldiers and button pushers. And the best advice for adults appears to be, if you can't beat the computer revolution, join it. Those selling computers are betting on it. The business is competitive. Computer firms are springing up everywhere. And computer salespersons have a difficult task. Their product is still relatively unknown, still somewhat expensive, and folks just don't know how to use computers. One answer to that last part?
Well, the best way to learn about a computer actually is to use a computer. The old classic University of Hard Knocks degree. You can go to take all the classes you want, and you can listen to all the people talk you want until you've made the mistakes and done the things, you know, tried the things that didn't work, you really aren't going to learn. And so the best way to learn about a computer is to use a computer.
And if you're still resisting the computer's lack of humanity,
the computers of today are getting more and more friendly, and as a trend, as a long-term trend, I see that will be the differences between computers in the future, is the friendliness toward the user.
And about those pitfalls, a soldier of the computer revolution.
I get really mad because I can't find the keys.
But the promises hold fast. A computer-oriented career in the offing for this young fellow. And for now...
It's easier than doing it on paper and stuff. Computers are neat because they do a lot of stuff. You can play games on them. You can also do your math and stuff on them.
And much, much more. I'm Doug Richards. Thank you.